ಮುಂಚಿನ ವರ್ಷ ಹೇಳಿ
ಪೂಜ್ಯ ಸ್ವಾಮಿ ಪರಮಾತ್ಮಾನಂದಜಿ ಮಹಾರಾಜ್, ಸ್ವಾಮಿ ಬುದ್ಧಾತ್ಮಾನಂದಜಿ ಮಹಾರಾಜ್, ಆನರಬಲ್ ಮಿನಿಸ್ಟರ್ ಸಾಹ್, ಜಸ್ಟಿಸ್ ಶ್ಯಾಮಲ್ ಕುಮಾರ್ ಸೇನ್ ಫಾರ್ಮರ್ ಗವರ್ನರ್ ಆಫ್ ವೆಸ್ಟ್ ಬಂಗಾಲ್ ಆ್ಯಂಡ್ ಫಾರ್ಮರ್ ಚೀಫ್ ಜಸ್ಟಿಸ್ ಆಫ್ ಅಲಹಾಬಾದ್ ಹೈಕೋರ್ಟ್, ಡಾಕ್ಟರ್ ಸುಭಾಷ್ ಚಂದ್ರ ಸಾಹ್, ಫಾರ್ಮರ್ ವೈಸ್ ಚಾನ್ಸಲರ್ ಅಸ್ಸಾಂ ಯೂನಿವರ್ಸಿಟಿ, ಡಾಕ್ಟರ್ ಪವಿತ್ರ ಗುಪ್ತಾ, ಫಾರ್ಮರ್ ವೈಸ್ ಚಾನ್ಸಲರ್ ಕಲ್ಯಾಣಿ ಕೃಷಿ ವಿಶ್ವವಿದ್ಯಾಲಯ, ಪ್ರೊಫೆಸರ್ ಸಮೀರ್ ಕುಮಾರ್ ಬಾಸು, ಡಿಸ್ಟಿಂಗ್ವಿಶ್ಡ್ ಡಿವೋಟೀ ಆಫ್ ಮಹಾತ್ಮ, ಡಿಸ್ಟಿಂಗ್ವಿಶ್ಡ್ ಇನ್ವೈಟೀಸ್, ಲೇಡೀಸ್ ಆ್ಯಂಡ್ ಜೆಂಟಲ್ಮೆನ್, ಐ ಆಮ್ ಥ್ಯಾಂಕ್ಫುಲ್ ಟು ಯು ಫಾರ್ ಇನ್ವೈಟಿಂಗ್ ಮೀ ಟು ಬಿ ಪ್ರೆಸೆಂಟ್ ಆನ್ ದಿ 150th ಬರ್ತ್ ಆನಿವರ್ಸರಿ ಆಫ್ ಸ್ವಾಮಿ ಅಭೇದಾನಂದಜಿ ಬೀಂಗ್ ಹೆಲ್ಡ್ ವಿತ್ ದ ಸೋಲ್ ಏಮ್ ಆಫ್ ರೀ ಅವೇಕನಿಂಗ್ ದಿ ಮಾಸ್ಟರ್ಸ್ ವಿತ್ ದಿ ಟೀಚಿಂಗ್ಸ್ ಆ್ಯಂಡ್ ಹೈ ಐಡಿಯಲ್ಸ್ ಆಫ್ ಸ್ವಾಮಿ ಅಭೇದಾನಂದ. Let us go to the beginning of 19th century Bengal. Hindu society was torn apart by the godless education of the West, cast adrift from the safe moorings of the sublime faith of their forefathers. Minds of men were tossed about by the skepticism and agnosticism, by doubts and disbelief in spiritual and moral spheres. The man who was destined to provide Hindu society with the desired vitality appeared in the person of Sri Ramakrishna in 1836. Kali Prasad Chandra, as Swami Abhedananda was known in his pre-monk days of Calcutta, was born on 2nd October 1866. A boy of remarkably sharp intellect and well versed in Sanskrit, Kali Prasad studied Wilson's History of India most meticulously in his school years and was profoundly impressed by Acharya Shankar, the great Advait Vedantist. With the gradual awakening of his soul and his spiritual thirst in his wife, Kali Prasad made a thorough study of Patanjali Darshan all by himself and was eagerly looking forward for a great yogi to learn the teachings of yoga. After inquiry, he came in contact with a great man, a great saint and a great yogi at the Chineshwar Kali temple of Rani Rasmani. He was Sri Ramakrishna, the priest of the Chineshwar Kali temple, who was enchanted by the ardent spiritual desire of young Kali Prasad and gladly agreed to be his mentor, that is guru. For Kali Prasad, it was a half glimpse of an awakening and a confirmation devoutly wished by the young boy. Thus began a lifelong association between the guru and the sishya, according to the age-old Indian tradition. When the master ended his earthly sojourn in Mahasamadhi, his young disciple Kali Prasad, along with his spiritual brothers, took a monastic vow to live in God consciousness with the undeterred aim to serve the suffering humanity, Bahujan Hitaya, Bahujan Sukhaya. From August 1896 to November 1921, Srimad Swami served as the cultural ambassador of India in the West and at the same moment became the legendary apostle of monism. His grand exposition of Vedantic ideals stunned the American professors and made him the leading scholar of Western world. The Reverend Swami reminded his audience about the glory of ancient Indian education, particularly in mathematics, cosmology and astronomy. We recall with reverence the prophetic words of Reverend Swami, and I quote, "I consider that the aim of education should not be we an intellectual culture with commercial ideals to gain our livelihood in the struggle of competition, but that the ideal of education should be such as will elevate man from his ordinary selfish state into the unselfish universal ideal of Godhood. Anything that makes us kneel down before that great ideal is uplifting." Unquote. The Swami continued in the same tenor, "The object of education should be the attainment of perfection. That is the highest aim of education and the reward monk advocated the spontaneous learning of Paravidya. Kishwari was fully conscious of women empowerment and women's education in the then India. He suggested founding separate schools and colleges solely with the women teachers for imparting education to girls so that they can imbibe age-old cherished Indian ideals of women. After coming back to his country, he advocated setting up of Indian colleges in the country and thorough learning of technical education. It was his hope that youth of the country should thus be self-dependent and the country will be industrialized, leading to vibrant motherland and prosperity to all. In 1924, the Swami purchased a cottage, Ruby Cottage, in Darjeeling, and established there the Ramakrishna Vedanta Ashram. On March 1, 1937, the Swami took the chair of the Parliament of Religions at the Town Hall of Calcutta, held to mark the birth anniversary of his master. There was deafening applause, and the Swami was greeted with a spontaneous outburst of emotion. The Swami described humbly his own self as the spiritual son of his master and his last surviving disciple. Swami Abhedananda Vedanta Society was first housed at Indian Hospital Road, then shifted to Vedan Street. The permanent abode was built on Raja Rajkrishna Street, Calcutta. In conclusion, we can express the quintessence of Abhedananda's thoughts on education thus, and I quote, "What we call genius is in reality immense power of concentration. Nothing can be achieved without concentration. There is no power in the universe higher than the power which comes through concentration. The power acquired by its practice can control all the physical forces of nature. The position of women in Hindu religion can be understood better by that unique idea of motherhood of God, which is nowhere so strongly expressed and recognized as in India. There is no other country in the world where every living mother is venerated as an incarnation of the Divine Mother," unquote. This is the summum bonum of Indian culture as envisaged by Revered Swami Abhedananda. May the children of this strife taught 21st century learn lessons of wisdom and tolerance from the teachings of the great saint Swami Abhedananda. With these words, I conclude and thank you again. Jai Hind.